The other major news this year, as I'm sure my colleague Richard here will go into in a bit greater detail when he takes the floor, is that the Elizabeth Line is used as a start in partnership. From December 2018, it's going to be used in phases. I think it's fair to say that the Greenwich branch gets the better deal because they get the new central section without having to interchange it. So maybe we'll do to Hampton, will be running from December 2018 this year. We've already taken management of Abbeywood Station. Maybe majority of the works that will even complete, but there are some works outstanding that you're aware of. We've started to introduce the new trains on the Liverpool Street to Shenfield route. There have been a few teething issues with the control system, the onboard control system, which we're working with. By December, we're fully confident that the line will be up and running and will have a transformational effect in terms of how people move around the city. And just there is, well, it's not very easy to see actually now, it's on the big screen. As you will see the purple line, we've now issued a new map which shows we'll be ready when the station comes in this year. I've also consulted on changing the bus fleet, should say fleet, not say bus fleet, changing the bus fleet to meet the changing demands of people, the way people go to travel as a result of the Elizabeth Line. This has been consulted on, the consultation is closed. Again, I would not want to preempt the result because we're working through the analysis now. It was a very large consultation, very detailed consultation, that looked across a number of routes across London, so we are working through the detail, but broadly it is about providing better connections to the stations, particularly from areas where we'll have the most benefits. It's about making sure that people, particularly in areas of on business route, people in Thamesmead and Bexley in particular have better access to Abbeywood and to Woolwich. We're aware that there were quite a lot of requests for additional services. We had to make a balanced judgment on what we thought was best. So for example, the route is prioritised people where it will make a real difference to how they can get into London. Areas which already have rail services in central London, then much of the line, it will normally still be quicker to get a train in central London and then transfer. It's more about those areas that are more reliant on bus services and making sure that they can get quick access to the Elizabeth Line. Again, that concept, the results of that conversation are due out within the next couple of months, I believe. In terms of service updates, Jubilee Line performance has been off target. It's a measure called lost customer hours. It's a fairly arcane way of measuring it. I'm not going to try and explain it because I don't fully understand myself. But basically, it's a total societal economic view of delays in Jubilee Line performance and the amount of time that customers lose by delays and by gaps in service. What I've got here on the screen is a breakdown in why, where those causes of the drop in performance are coming from. What you can see is there is about 20%, which is fleet, which is problems with the trains and the job they want to. 20%, which is staffing, which is either people not being able to sit into work because of illness or potential strikes, things like that. But what is a big chunk, third, is down to customers. And there are a number of reasons behind that. One of them is the delays which are caused when passengers fall at the lost trains. We've recently launched a campaign about this because what we find happens is that if someone feels faint or falls on our train, people rush to say, step away, leave them where they are, where actually what the best thing for them to do, and this advice has come from the London Ambulance Service, it's not just sort of being cynical and thinking about performance, is actually get them off the train where it's cooler and where the other side can get to them. What you actually see is quite a number of doctors and nurses going, you should leave them where they are, which actually the London Ambulance Service do not support that because they want them off the train where they can administer help to them. So we have a campaign which is ongoing now. If you go to the next station, you may hear announcements saying someone falls ill, help them off the train. And this is something that we're trying to do. There's passengers on train, which is an unfortunate acronym there, but has been dropping now over the last 12 months as we've been looking, working with the ambulance service and working with passengers to try and help us. There is also, we have further plans to develop that form. Lots of pilot light You've ever been on a tube train and as it started, felt it suddenly jerked to the halt and then start again? What that is that the doors, when they come apart a little bit, the pilot light goes out, it stops the train. We think on the Jubilee train, in fact, frankly, this is oversensitive and it's overprotecting against the real risk. So we're currently looking at updating the software on that. And you also have been a deadline in March to engage with customers to really tackle some of these reliability issues. We've also, this spring, are going to introduce a new timetable. This is part of the efficiencies that we've been working through for the past year, included bringing together some of our engineering functions. And one of the benefits of that is actually we've been able to look at some of the timetable in Northern Wine recently announced the timetable. So we're going to be extending the 30 trains per hour, by 60 minutes. So it covers a long period of time. And there'll be a high frequency in the central section. That's achieved in part by more turning around in places like North Greenwich to make sure that the busy part of the line gets a better service. So from May, we should expect to see certainly from Greenwich heading into town more frequent, better service, and for a longer period during the week. We have now proceeded with the order in for our new fleet of trains. We've got four bidders who've been invited to the next stage of the procurement process. This will provide 43 new walk-through trains, air conditioned trains, from 2022. This will actually help increase. One of the constraints we have, frankly, right now on the DLR, because as you may be aware, performance is routinely up around 99% bar. The remaining challenge, I suppose, to tackle, or the most pressing remaining challenge for us to tackle on the DLR, is capacity, as it becomes more, because of the reliability, it is very popular. Unfortunately, that's constrained by the fact we only have so many trains. This will help us fix that, along with the introduction of the one which we expect to take away some of the demand going centrally from the central London from Canary Wharf, which will also mean we can configure the service a little bit. So we can provide more frequent service and more allowable to send because of the brand service as well. So that process is proceeding now. Also, they introduced a new map which delineates the different bits of the DLR. We've had complaints for some time now about the fact that the DLR map looks confusing because it just looked like one big sort of spot, fiery splotch at Teal. And it wasn't always very clear where people had to exchange onto the trains, so we've listened to customers, we've addressed that. That was introduced last year as part of our 30 years of DLR meetings. Performance on the route is still around the 99% mark, and it is on target for customer service, we are on target for reliability and waiting time. The one area where we've fallen off target is the number of 20-minute delays we've seen. I've been surprised the meeting, I did a little bit of investigating into this to see there was an underlying root cause, and there isn't, frankly, one root cause of why we've seen a spike in that recently. There have been a couple of issues with trespass on getting onto the track. There have been a couple of instances of fire alarms going off in stations, but broadly speaking, there doesn't seem to be one root cause where we can say this is an area that we can clearly identify as causing this spike in delays and to tackle it. But it's something obviously we're going to be monitoring going forward along with the others that we've got things to our operator. What plans for the Woolwich Ferry are progressing? Got two new boats coming in this year to replace the current fleet, which will be using a new high-tech mooring system. The installation of that is going to happen this October, and will mean that the Woolwich Ferry will be out of action from October to December. This will obviously have short-term effects, and we will be working with yourselves, with other transport operators, and with the freight industry in particular to make sure that it's well publicised so we don't end up on a huge number of vehicles heading up to the ferry and having to turn back around again. We don't think it's going to have a massive impact on for example, Blackwell Tunnel, because actually the numbers, when you're talking about something like over 90,000 vehicles a day go for directions through Blackwell, compared to about 4,500 every day on the port train. So wouldn't expect it to have a horrendous impact on Blackwell Tunnel, but obviously we need to make sure that we're doing it properly so that it doesn't have a definite impact on work. The benefits we're going to get out of that is have cleaner, more fuel efficient, quieter boats, obviously you would say more reliable as well, more space, better segregated space for cyclists, step-free access and enhanced safety features. This is a huge positive story, and it obviously demonstrates our commitment to maintaining this service rather than letting it go as managed before. That, I would say, will be, it does mean we do need that closure. Separately from that, as we mentioned, I have got a slide here, but we're carrying out works at Greenwich here as well. We had hoped that we were going to be able to do all that on site, but it is going to require a number of short-term closures, first of two of which are coming later this month.